Hi everyone. I hope you're studying sincerely during this pandemic. So let's move today with a new topic. Now, as we all know that, you know, some of the characteristics we get it from our parents, right? From some characteristic we get it from our mother, some characteristic we get it from our father. So what is happening? The characteristic has been passed from one generation to the next generation. Correct? So for that, we have a process, we have a word, we have a term that we say it as heredity. And this, you know, passing of the traits from one generation to the next, it is kind of a continuous process. That continuous process which leads to variations, okay, that you would term it as what? The evolution. So the chapter's name, you almost got it, that's heredity and evolution. Okay, now whenever I use the word heredity, what does it basically mean? It is the passing of traits. T-R-A-I-T-S. Traits means what? Characteristics. Okay, so it is a passing of traits from one generation to the next generation. So basically it is a passing of characteristic from one generation to the next generation. That is termed as heredity. Right? Now when I say inherited traits, the traits that is passed from one generation to the next generation, no doubt, but inherited trait is a trait that you have been already taken from the parents. Say for example, maybe a eye color, the ear lobe, some has free ear lobe, some has attached one, right? So these are kind of, you know, inherited traits that has been come from the birth itself, right? That has been come from the birth itself. Okay, so these are inherited traits. Now, genetics is the branch of science that deals with the study of heredity. Okay, genetics is a branch of the science that deals with the study of heredity. So, who is known as the father of genetics? It is none other than Sir Gregor Johann Mendel. He was the father of genetics, and because of him we actually came to know what is heredity, right? So we all know the organism carry out asexual and sexual reproduction. We have already come across this in our reproduction chapter, correct? But we should also know one thing, that heredity also plays an important role in both the reproduction, that is asexual as well as sexual reproduction. Right? So when I talk about Mendel's experiment, Mendel had performed some experiments related to heredity, and he actually performed the experiments with a seed that is known as garden pea. In normal language we say it as a common name, right? But if I have to say it in a scientific name, it would be what? Pisum sativum. Okay, so he carried out his experiment with these seeds. So the first set of experiment that I would like to explain it to you, what did Mendel do? He performed some experiments wherein he gave some principles of inheritance. When I say principle of inheritance has three different laws. The first is what? The law of dominance. The second is law of segregation. And the third one is law of independent assortment. So what are the principles of inheritance that Mendel gave? It is first one, principle of dominance, or you can say it as law of dominance. Second is principle of segregation, then principle of independent assortment. So these are the three principles of inheritance which Mendel gave. Okay, we are going to study all the three principles in detail. So let's go with the first set of experiment what Mendel had done. Now Mendel took one pea plant which was tall, okay, and another which was dwarf. So the character he took is what? Is height of the plant. When I'm saying tall, when I'm saying dwarf, dwarf is what character? Small character, right? Small plant. Okay, so one pea plant which was tall, he took that, and another he took a dwarf pea plant. Now when I talk about a tall pea plant, we denote it as capital T. Okay, when I talk about dwarf pea plant, we denote it as small t. Fine. So, what is the character here? The character is height. Okay. So, he cross-pollinated these plants, and the result obtained was all the plants were tall. Okay. All the plants were tall. So, if I have to represent a tall plant, I would represent it as capital T's. Okay, if I have to represent a dwarf plant, I would represent it as small T's. Why it is tall, why it is dwarf, why it is denoted as capital and why it is denoted as small, I would be explaining it to you the moment I complete this particular experiment. Okay, so after cross-pollination, what was the result obtained? The result obtained was all the plants were tall. Okay, so the plants that was obtained were all tall. This he named it as what? The filial generation, or you can see it as F1 generation. Okay, now the question arises, Mendel took one tall plant and one dwarf plant, and when he cross-pollinated, how come all the plants were tall, wherein there was a dwarfness characteristic in the plant, correct? So after this result, he tried taking out the F1 generation plant and self-pollinated it. The result obtained was what? Almost out of 100%, 75% of the plants showed tallness and 25% of the plants showed dwarfness. Okay, so he named this as what? The another filial generation, that is F2 generation. Now Mendel was satisfied with the result of the F2 generation. Why? Because somewhere the characteristic of dwarfness got expressed where? In the F2 generation. Okay, so two copies of the traits are inherited in each sexually reproducing organisms. One tallness and the other was dwarfness. Now what I told you that I would be explaining it to you later on, why it is capital T's and why it is small T's, because there is a term that we need to learn, is one is dominant character and one is recessive character. Okay, now when I talk about the dominant character, it is the trait that gets expressed in the offspring. Okay, the trait that gets expressed is termed as a dominant character, and the trait that has been hidden, meaning the trait that remains hidden and dominated by the dominant trait, is called the recessive character. Now if I have to give an example of a dominant character in the Mendel's first experiment that I already explained to you, in F1 generation the tall trait got expressed, so tallness is the dominance character, correct? In F1 generation what happened, we all know, all the plants were what? Tall, and all these plants showed tallness as a characteristic. Why? Because it was expressing, the trait was expressing itself, right? And what about the trait which was remain hidden, that you would term it as which trait? Recessive trait, right? For example, what? The F2 generation. In F2 generation, the trait got expressed which was hidden, right? Somewhere the dwarfness character which was there in the F1 generation, that got expressed in the F2 generation. Okay, so basically when we have to say a dominant character and a recessive character, the denotation for the dominance is always in capital and for the recessive is always in small. But now here also there are different cases. Okay, now different cases means what? If I say capital TT, you would say it as what? Tall plant. But if I name this as homozygous tall plant, what would you say? It is a homozygous tall plant. Why homozygous? Because the organisms with the identical alleles, they are termed as what? Homozygous organisms. Okay, the organisms with the identical alleles, they are termed as homozygous organisms. Now here what example can I take? Capital TT, if you have to cross-pollinate with capital TT, means what? Tall plant, cross-pollinate with tall plant, what you would obtain? You would obtain all capital TTs which will be homozygous organism, right? Be it a dominant, be it a recessive one, correct? In the same way, if I have to take an example to small TT. Small TT, if you cross-pollinate with small TT, what will happen? It will give rise to all small TTs, but it is identical, right? It is identical. Now, when I use the word identical alleles, alleles means what? It is a trait which is basically denoted by letters. Okay, the traits which are basically denoted by letters. Now if I say tall plant, it would be capital TTs. If I say dwarf plant, it would be small TTs. And if I say tall and dwarf plant, capital T and small t, right? And if I say dwarf and tall, it would be small t and capital T. Remember one thing, that if a capital T is accompanying with a small t, always the one which will get expressed would be the dominant trait, that is the capital T. Okay, and even if it is vice versa, say dwarf and tall, it is T and T, that is small t and capital T. The dominant character is still there, so obviously the one that would get expressed is the dominant character. He would say this small t and capital T as what? As a dominant trait, that is tall plant. Okay, so I was in the topic, that is homozygous. Now you understand what is homozygous organism? The organism with the identical alleles are termed as homozygous organisms. Fine. Almost vice versa would be the heterozygous organisms. Meaning what? The organisms with different alleles. Correct? The organisms with different alleles are heterozygous organisms. Now they are also called as hybrids. Correct? Because they are different alleles, they are giving rise to different alleles. Now here what example can you take? If I take a small capital T and a small t, which cross pollinate with capital T and a small t, the gamete will give rise to capital T small t, capital T small t here. Correct? Now if I have to cross pollinate all the four, how would I do? One resultant would be capital T small t. The another resultant would be small t small t. The another one capital T, the another last one capital T small t. All of the four are what? They are different alleles. Correct? One is small, one is one capitals, one is accompanied one capital with one small. So all are with different alleles, right? These organisms are with different alleles. So you would say this as what? Heterozygous organisms. Correct? You would say this as what? Heterozygous organisms. Correct, everyone? Now, we go with the next terminologies that we need to learn. The first terminologies that you need to learn is one is autosomes. Now, when I talk about autosomes, these are the chromosomes other than sex chromosomes. Okay? The chromosomes other than sex chromosome, you will name it as what? Autosomes. And it determines all other traits other than sex of an individual. Okay? So, it exists in pairs always. So, that is the one that controls the somatic traits. Now, when I say somatic traits, what do you mean by a somatic trait? Somatic trait is the one that does not involve in reproductive cells, meaning no reproduction is there here, which means there is the somatic characteristic when I talk about. It is nothing related to reproductive characteristic. It is something apart from reproductive, from non-reproductive cells that is getting associated with. Okay. So, for example, you can say like hair color, the eye color. You don't need any reproductive part here for a hair color, right? It is a somatic trait. Fine. The second term that we have to get to learn about is sex chromosome. Now, one, autosomes which is not involved in the sex chromosome. These are the chromosomes that are other than the sex chromosome, these are autosomes. So, the sex chromosomes are the chromosome which determine the sex of an individual, right? In humans, one pair of chromosomes exist in male, that is what? X and Y, right? Whereas for female, it is XX, right? We all know these. Now, when I talk about a diploid and a haploid world. Now, diploid are the cells with two complete sets of chromosome and it includes all the somatic cells. So, all the somatic cells, the characteristics which we get it from the parents to the offspring, that kind of a characteristic, name it as a somatic cell. Whereas the haploid is the cells with single complete set of chromosome. Fine. Now, the next one that we have to learn about is what? The genetic basis of the sex determination. What are the genetic basis of a sex determination? Now, if I have to schematically show you, now if this is a parent, okay, that is the male and the female. Now, the male would have 44 autosomes plus XY, the sex chromosome, whereas the female with the 44 chromosome plus XX, the sex chromosome, correct? Now, these will have the gametes. One is the sperm, second is the ovum. Now, if the sperm has to represent as what? 22 plus 1 X, 22 plus 1 Y. In the same way, female would be 22 plus 1 X, 22 plus 1 X, right? So, what would be the resultant zygote here? One, it would be 44 plus XX, right? Next, 44 plus XX. Next, 44 plus XY. Next, 44 plus XY. So, the resultant zygote or the offspring would be the female child here and the male child here. Correct? Yes. So each human cells contains 23 pairs of chromosomes. Out of 23 pairs, 22 pairs are same in both male and female. So these are called as autosomes. Correct? And one pair which differs in males and females is called sex chromosome. Now when I talk about a male, 22 pairs of autosomes plus, so these are what the somatic traits, plus one pair of sex chromosome, that is XY. When I talk about a female, 22 pairs of autosomes plus one pair of sex chromosome, that is XX. Correct? So when I say autosomes, these are all basically what cells, the traits, that is all related to somatic traits. Correct? And when I talk about one sex chromosome, we know a sex chromosome would be an XY or an XX. Right? So the sex of the offspring is determined by what? Fusion of an egg and a sperm. Correct? Now if I have to talk about the structure of a chromosome. Now the structure of the chromosome differs in prokaryotes as well as in eukaryotes. Right? So the prokaryotes, like you can give an example for bacteria, that does not have a membrane bound nucleus, right? So have single circular DNA, much smaller in comparison to a single chromosome of a eukaryote. Okay, so in eukaryotes, the number of chromosomes present varies from species to species. Correct? Now, if I have to go in detail about Mendel's experiment. Now, if I already have explained you Mendel's one set of experiment about the tallness and the dwarfness that we took the character as height. So, if I have to explain you in terms of homozygous and heterozygous, let me explain to you in this way. So, he took what? Tall pea plant. Till now, we knew this. But if I have to modify it properly and scientifically, how would I say? He took homozygous tall plant, that is capital T, homozygous, identical alleles, right? And homozygous dwarf plant, small t's. So homozygous again identical. So he has to cross-pollinate these plants. So capital T cross-pollinated with small t's. The gamete formation is one capital, one small. When you have to cross-pollinate it, when you have to cross it, how would you cross it? The first capital T combined with the first small t would be capital T small t. The first capital T combined with the second, it would be one capital, one small. In the same way, the second capital T combined with the first small t, it would be capital T small t. Then again, the same capital T and small t. So this was what F1 generation. You remember, what did the F1 generation represent? All the dominant trait. Yes or no? Since can you see when it is expressed capital T small t? Yes, the dwarfness is coming into with the capital T, but it is not getting expressed. Why? Because there is a dominant trait which already got expressed, that is capital T. Okay, so all the plants, you would name it as what? Heterozygous tall plants. Fine. Now he took these F1 generation and self-pollinated them. What did he find? Capital T small t, one capital T small t. He took the F1 generation and self-pollinated it. The gamete formation is one capital, one small t, one capital T, one small t. And when he got the F2 generation, it was one was homozygous tall plant. Second was heterozygous tall plant. Third was homozygous dwarf plant. And the fourth, heterozygous tall plant. I hope you're understanding what the meaning of homozygous and heterozygous, right? Homozygous is the one that is identical or alleles. The organism which have identical alleles. Whereas heterozygous are the one that is organisms with the not identical one, right? Meaning what? They are different, right? So with this observation, Mendel concluded that even the dwarfness character which was present in F1 generation, that got expressed where? In the F2 generation. right? So I hope you understood this concept of Mendel's experiment and some terminologies that we already concluded with, that is autosome, sex chromosome, diploid, haploid, etc., homozygous, heterozygous, alleles, right? Heredity, evolution. So evolution, we are going to learn it in detail later on, but right now we are focusing in with the first topic, that is heredity. Okay, kindly go through it properly. Without the representation with the schematic is not possible. So please study well. Thank you so much.